Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
Hello, and welcome to the Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update. My name is Yvonne Stroman. I'm the Community Program Specialist at the Council on Chemical Abuse. Welcome to our program. The Council on Chemical Abuse is Berks County's single county authority. We're responsible for the planning of prevention, treatment, intervention, and recovery services. We help to coordinate those efforts so that people living and suffering from the disease of addiction can have the best chance of recovery and sustain long-term sobriety. According to NIDA, which is the National Institute on Drug Abuse, using drugs, alcohol, or tobacco during pregnancy exposes harm, not just to the woman, but also her developing fetus, and can have potentially harmful effects in the long term. For example, smoking during pregnancy can increase risk to stillbirth, infant mortality, sudden infant death syndrome, preterm birth, respiratory problems, slowed fetal growth, and low birth weight. Drinking during pregnancy can lead to child developing fetal alcohol spectrum disorders, characteristic by low birth weight and enduring cognitive and behavioral problems. Prenatal use of some drugs, including opioids, may cause a withdrawal syndrome in newborns called neonatal abstinence syndrome. Babies with neonatal abstinence syndrome are at greater risk of seizures, respiratory problems, feeding difficulties, low birth weight, and even death. It is important to provide pregnant women valuable information, education, and supportive services, which are critical to providing comprehensive and coordinated services for pregnant women and their unborn children. With me to talk more about these services that are available in Berks County for pregnant women and their unborn infant is Jami, Geist, and Karol, Roldan, both from Reading Hospital. And I'm gonna ask them if they wouldn't mind talking more specifically about their role and the, you can tell me the program. It's escaping me right now, Jami.
Soft landing program.
Thank you. So would you introduce yourself? Thank you for joining me and just kind of talk to us a little bit about your role within that safe landing program for mom and children.
Thanks for having us here, Yvonne. I really appreciate it. I'm Jami Geist. I'm the project manager for the Soft Landing Program. So I do a little bit of everything. I accept referrals. I work with our care coordinators and our therapist to make sure we're providing the best services we can. I work within the hospital to look at what services we're providing to women who are pregnant and have substance use disorders. And so just trying to make sure that we are doing everything we can to help the patients that we serve.
Thank you. And Karol, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. My name is Karol, and I am one of the care coordinators for the Soft Landing Program. I am kind of the middle person between medical needs and social needs. So we do a little bit of everything for them.
And Jami, is this a relatively new program? It's out of the Reading Hospital. And so how did this kind of come into being, if you will? I mean, it hasn't always been around, right? It's relatively new programming. Can you say more about it?
Sure. It has not always been around, but the hospital has been working with women with substance use disorder for many years now at the Women's Health Center, providing Suboxone to pregnant women up until a year after their delivery. And so they were able to get prenatal care and also medication-assisted treatment in one location. And from that, sprung the need for the Center of Excellence. And so 7 years ago, the hospital opened the Opioid Use Disorder Center of Excellence, where they continue to work with people with opiate use disorders. And from doing that work through the Women's Health Center and the Center of Excellence, they found that pregnant and postpartum women have additional needs that they weren't able to meet with the services, with what was able we were able to provide at the hospital at that time. So in 2021, they started the Soft Landing Program. And so I came on board in March of 2021, right near basically at the beginning of the program. We had one care coordinator on board and a therapist before I got here. And so we were just starting out at that point. And here we are over 3 years later.
And I think it's really important too for the Berks County community to understand that this is out of a need, you know, based on the growing number of women, pregnant women with an opioid use disorder, but also other substance use disorders, wouldn't you say? Alcohol use disorder, marijuana use disorder. And so I don't want folks to just think, well, it's just pregnant women with opioid addiction, but also there are women who are pregnant who have other substance use disorders that can benefit from your program, right?
Yes, thank you for pointing that out, Yvonne. We started initially through a DDAP grant that was to work with women who were using opioids or stimulants. And then a couple years into our program, we were able to get to change our funding to get funded through COCA. And that allowed us to open up to be able to serve women with any substance use disorder. So now we are working with women who are using alcohol, marijuana, and yeah, any substance use disorder. So we've been able to expand that because they need help too.
And I can't help but think, and so I'm going to date myself here a little bit, Jami, but you know, the reality is that, you know, there was a period of time, according to a doctor, that might say, oh, well, you know, a glass of wine isn't necessarily going to be harmful. Growing up during a time where you actually saw pregnant women more so smoking cigarettes. And that was because there wasn't that type of research available. And now what we know is that, you know, anything that mom takes into her body, the fetus is affected and impacted. And so I'm just wondering if, you know, people who are still in that, I had a glass of wine when I was pregnant and you turned out, but what do we know through research today? And I'm just wondering if either one of you be willing to just kind of mention that there is new evidence out there that can say that these are harmful.
Absolutely. We, over time, have learned that there is no safe amount of alcohol. There's no set amount that we can say is a safe amount to drink during pregnancy. It is really unknown how much alcohol you can drink and not cause fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. And so the safest route is to avoid alcohol during pregnancy to prevent that. Sadly, I've seen television shows where they showed pregnant women drinking at their bridal shower, even, maybe 15 years ago. And so it is still something that, you know, you can see portrayed in media. But I think a lot more people understand now the dangers of alcohol use during pregnancy.
So then let's kind of unpack this a little bit more and then just say, what is the impact of babies affected by prenatal substance use? Perhaps talk about how is that impactful to the baby? And then even in terms of mom at once giving birth, because we know that there's some element of, you know, having to deal with the withdrawal, right, from substances, I know is part of that, but just wondering if both of you or either one of you wanna talk a little bit even more about that.
A lot of the effects depend on a lot of factors. It is really, I can't tell you if you use this substance, this is exactly what's gonna happen. And you mentioned a lot of the effects already, and there's a lot of variety. And there's a lot of times you can't necessarily see the effects at delivery. You're not necessarily going to see those effects right away. But there are some things that are possibilities that we see with, one of the things that we know is that cutting back or stopping tobacco use is one of the best things that you can do. Because if you add tobacco use to other substances like alcohol or other drugs, that intensifies the effects on infants. with low birth weight and the possible of premature birth. And if somebody is using multiple substances during their pregnancy, throughout their pregnancy, that can also complicate, that create more effects after delivery. And so there are certain things that we know that can make things worse, but it's very hard to say with, you know, absolutely that something is definitely going to happen. But there are risks. And so using substances during pregnancy absolutely comes with risks of, as I said, low birth weight, premature birth, with babies born with opiate exposure. They may have a high-pitched cry, tremors, muscle tightness that go along with the opiate withdrawal. One of the great things that happens here at the hospital is we have the Eat, Sleep, Console program. And so the babies that are born with neonatal opiate withdrawal syndrome can go to the pediatric floor, and their caregiver can stay with them, whether it be mom, dad, grandparents can stay with them throughout that time and comfort them and hold them. And they found that that is the best care for them during that time of withdrawal. And so mom gets support by being in the hospital, and then the infant gets support by being able to stay with their caregivers.
Thank you for that. And Karol, I just wanted, if there's anything else that you wanted to add in terms of what your role is and how do you navigate the delivery of services to the mom during the gestational period? Are you taking referrals and then giving them to a coordinated care person? How are you managing that in terms of working with the doctors?
So my job as a care coordinator, we usually get the referrals from the OB office. However, we also accept referrals from friends, family, self-referred. And my job is to pretty much assess the patient and see what are their needs, whether they're medical, whether they're social needs. We usually are with them through their pregnancy, help them with their appointments, help them if they are interested in MAT programs. We kind of help them with that too. We kind of meet them where they're at to ensure that they're getting the prenatal care that they need and any other social needs that they have. We can help them out with that.
Because I can imagine, particularly if there is a mom with a diagnosis of a mild, moderate, or severe substance use disorder, opiate use disorder, marijuana use disorder, you know, there's that management of, you know, management withdrawal, right? And then how does mom navigate not only going through the withdrawal process for herself, but also dealing with then, because there's another part of that during the gestational period, the pregnancy, and all the emotions and physical changes that go through all that. I mean, I can only imagine that it's probably compiled because of you're dealing with the two. You're now having to go through withdrawal, right? Stop using, right? And what that feels like, but also the emotional and physical changes that just happen naturally from being pregnant. And so, you know, I was just wondering if you can kind of speak to working with women in that regard, because the program is voluntary, right? Let's say that there is no court or governmental body saying you must do this. It's very much on their own voluntary basis. And even just kind of the hormone imbalance through all of that, your role is being really that service support, right, of meeting them where they're at. How does that work?
Honestly, it's a case by case, because every mom is different, every pregnancy is different, every experience is different. So it's a matter of, I guess, bonding with the mom, trying to establish a rapport with the mom and seeing what their needs are and where I fit in, whether that is helping them with getting connected for mental health help, whether that is, you know, if the medical needs is taking priority, if the withdrawals are too much, then we can talk to the OB doctor, go from there. Also addiction medicine, they can come in the picture. It all variates on the mom and what their situation is.
And in terms of meeting mom, did you want to say something else, Jami? I'm sorry.
I did, yeah. So in dealing with withdrawal, it's recommended that women who are using opiates while they're pregnant start medication-assisted treatment so that if they may have to go through some withdrawal in part of that process of starting MAT, but we try to reduce that, and women can come in and stay in the hospital to get to transitioned onto Suboxone or methadone to start get that process started so that their withdrawal symptoms can be managed in that way. So we do try to work with women and help them to get services and care to minimize the withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah, and Jami, I got to say, in terms of MAT, it really is under the care of the doctor, right? And, yes. And so under the care of the doctor helps them be able to manage their day-to-day life, right? Going through that withdrawal, and they're not necessarily going, the withdrawal isn't so harmful as to where they say, well, this is too much and I got to go back to my drug of choice and doing, you know, the full, what I've been doing in terms of the quantity and that type of thing. This is safely and effectively helping mom manage the withdrawal process, which is a safer way for her and her baby.
Exactly.
And I also need to just kind of mention, because you talked about, Karol, those services and meeting where they're at. I mean, you guys, in terms of that coordinated care, you're going with them to the doctor's visits, you're meeting them in their homes. And I think I mentioned these because these are really non-traditional approaches, right? Usually, you know, instead you're not telling them, well, go to that doctor, see that doctor, and then report back to me in my office. But instead you're saying, I can come pick you up, take you to the doctor, be there for your support mechanism, meet you at your home or, you know, at the donut shop or something. And I think what I appreciate about this is that the service is oftentimes without walls. It isn't about them coming into your office, sitting across the desk from you saying, well, did you do this? Let's check this off. It's not a check the box. It really is, to your point, about developing that relationship which can be critical and so important to examine that level of trust that they have in you. And you also mentioned, I'm wondering, when does that start? You know, does mom have to be 3 months pregnant or 6 months pregnant? At which point does that start in terms of the referral? Any given time during that gestation period?
At any given time. As soon as that referral comes in, we can start working with them.
Even after delivery.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
Thank you, because that's my next point. And how long can mom and baby stay with you in terms of receiving services?
So our program is voluntary, and we usually would provide the services up until the youngest child is 3. However, mom does not have to be in the program the entire 3 years. Also, if we are working with mom and she happens to get pregnant again, then it'll be up until that baby's 3. So,
and I think it's also worth mentioning, you know, because it is voluntary, sometimes moms, you know, can feel very overwhelmed by oftentimes some of the things that is now new to them in terms of being a first-time mom, of being going to doctors, of going to different appointments, and it can be very overwhelming. And so my question is, can somebody begin with you, maybe feel overwhelmed and say, I need to take a break, and then contact you at a later time for the continuation of those services?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I think I appreciate that, because oftentimes, again, when you're thinking about traditional services, you know, you're asking somebody to sign a paper to say you're going to be with us for at least 6 months or 9 months of continuation. And that doesn't have to be the case here. It really is about providing a support service for mom and meeting mom where they're at so that she feels that she is getting the services that she needs at the time that she needs them.
Absolutely.
And Can you talk about the coordination of care with families, you know, extended family members? You know, because I heard you say that sometimes family members may feel, what's the word I want to say, a little overwhelmed with mom as well. And so is there any information that you could provide for the family members that can help them get additional information and education about whether it is, you know, substance use disorder, you know, helping mom during those tender months and years, anything that you help with the families for to help support mom?
So it all depends on where the family is at and how involved they are, but we can definitely connect them with other community resources that can focus on helping the family help our patients. And there are great programs out there for that, specifically for the family to help mom.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Work together.
Absolutely. And I'm just wondering, you know, the other question sometimes that stands out there, and I've had conversations with individuals who believe that, well, why can't they just stop? This is a mom, you find out you're pregnant, and you know you're going to be having a baby. You want this baby to be safe. Why can't you just stop?
And that is a very, very common thought, I think, for a lot of people. And what I see there is some people can, and some people can. And a lot of times it depends on severity, and it depends on what they're using, and it depends on a lot of factors. All people with substance use disorders face stigma, and I think pregnant moms most of all, because it is hard for people to look and say and understand, you know, well, why doesn't she just stop? There's a lot of things that are unsafe in pregnancy. Sushi, hot dogs, soft cheeses. There's a lot, you know, and you got to change your diet. You try to eat a healthier diet. And those changes are hard for a lot of people. And so we know that not all pregnant moms can even make those changes, right? And so when you look at something like substance use disorder, what it tells me when a mom is struggling with stopping her substance use is that shows to me the strength of addiction. And that's the power of substance use disorder, that it can override what we could call the, you know, maternal instinct, which is also very strong. Right. And so if there's something that can override that, that just shows you the strength of substance use disorder, that it can override that. And then what that turns into is mom internalizes that stigma. And so women then, you know, they are saying the same things to themselves that they're hearing, you know, or believe that other people are saying. And then it becomes a cycle of that shame and guilt and fear to go get help and to be able to get the services that they need. Because they're scared and they feel terrible. And so that makes it even harder to stop using because they feel so awful. And so that is really what it comes down to for me.
Yeah, I think also too, as you mentioned that, depending upon the drug of choice and how long they've been, the method they've been using it into the quantity, it can actually be detrimental. Because of the withdrawal that for some of the drugs, it may not be, that's why medication assisted treatment is so helpful, is yeah. Because to just stop cold turkey can actually be more harmful than not, right?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
And so we've talked a little bit about soft landing and gave kind of the particulars in terms of the coordinated care and working with the mom and, getting those referrals. So if there's anyone that is actually listening to the program and maybe they want to self-refer, because that's part of it too, how can someone gain access to the care coordination?
We have a website, which is one of the programs listed on the bewellberks.org website. So if you go there and you go to programs, you can find Soft Landing, and there is a referral form that you can fill out, and we'll receive that form and get in contact with you. Or you can call 484 628-9050.
And what is the turnaround time, Jami? If somebody submits something today, you're calling them tomorrow?
Absolutely. We will try to call them as quickly as we can. Yeah. So we've gotten referrals at 8 o'clock in the morning and, you know, called them at 8:15. So.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. Is there services available in both English and Spanish?
Yes. And Karol is our bilingual care coordinator. And so that's why we are, one of the reasons we wanted her to be here so you can meet her. We think that's it's really important for us to be able to provide.
It's a very needed service in our communities. Absolutely. Absolutely. And I also like to mention that the services are free. They don't cost, there's no cost to mom for receiving these services, correct?
Correct. And we do have a therapist on staff, which I think is super important because we want our women to get therapy services as soon as possible. And we will bill insurance for that service if we can, but there is still no charge to mom.
Yeah, and I appreciate you mentioning that because it's really a comprehensive wellness service deliverable that you are providing for mom and her unborn child to make sure that she has the most supportive services in the most efficient and adequate way so that she's able to give a healthy delivery. Just was wondering if you could kind of mention for information, is there a website if people want to kind of go and look for more information on soft landing? Is there a website that they can, that you can mention? Do you know?
That would be the bewellberks.org website. Yeah. There's a lot of other programs here at the hospital that are on that website, but you can find us listed under the programs. It's the soft landing program.
And so I'm just curious, I didn't ask this before, I'm wondering if a woman is not affiliated with Reading Hospital, say she goes to Penn State, can she still receive services to soft landing?
Absolutely, yes. Okay. Wherever they're going to get prenatal care, they can still come and see us.
That's beautiful. Is there a age range? Is it 18 to... 18 on up?
We've had 15, 16 year olds. Under 18 and then up to, we've had women who were in their 40s.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. And, you know, we had this very nice conversation. I really appreciate the work that you guys do. And thank you for carving time out of your schedules today. Is there anything that you want to mention in the last few seconds that we have that I did not ask you that I think is for the good of our conversation today?
For anyone out there who may be in the situation where they're pregnant and using substances, I just want to say, get help, ask for help, ask your OB doctor, talk to them, let them know what's going on. They're there to help you. They want to treat this as a part of your health care because it's a disease like any other medical problem that you might be having. They're not there to judge you. They just want to get you the help that you need so you can have the best possible outcome for you and your baby.
Very well said. Very well said, Jami. Thank you so much. And we want to thank the Berks County viewers for tuning in and watching us today. And as I mentioned, if you have any questions about the services at the Council on Chemical Abuse, please feel free to reach out to us at 610-376-8669 or visit our website at COCABERKS, that's COCABERKS.org. In the meantime, this has been the Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update. We want to thank you for joining us. Stay safe, stay cool. Until next time.
The Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.